Welcome to Google Plus Developers Live. My name is Chris Cartland, and I'm a developer programs engineer working on the Google Plus platform.
And I'm Yaniv Yakubovich. I'm a product manager in the Google Plus platform.
Thanks for joining us this week. Today, we're going to talk about verifying tokens that you receive from your client apps on your server. So first, we're going to talk about when you need to do this, when it's important. We're going to talk about why and the kind of things that you want to avoid in your app. And we're also going to tell you how to do it. We're going to look at some code that we have on GitHub to actually show you how to get this done.
And while we're doing this broadcast, you can have a comment and questions for us either on our Google Plus or channel or on YouTube, wherever you watch this video.
Yeah, and we'll be sure to get those questions at the end. So first of all, we have to talk about what we're doing here. We're talking about requests coming from your client to your server. So if we look on my screen here, we can see that we're going to make requests. And there's two things that you can do. One is that you could send an authorization code. And we cover that in all of our quick starts. So you can check those out at developers.google.com/plus. Look for the quick starts. Pick your favorite language. And that's one way to make establish an authenticated connection with your client and your server. Today, we're going to talk about a different way to do this, and that is by sending either an ID token or an access token to your server. The code for this is available on github.com/googleplus for either the quick starts or for the samples that tell you how to verify the tokens. So first, a little background. What are these two different types of tokens that we're going to be talking about today? The first is an ID token. And an ID token it contains information about the user and who they are. And it's also cryptographically signed by Google so that you can verify that this is a real token.
And we'll show you later in the code how we can verify that it's a Google token and not other token.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. An access token is a bearer token that can be used to make API calls to Google. And you need to make sure that you verify those every time your server receives them as well. If you are going to decide which one of these to use, remember that an ID token is a way to identify who a user is very quickly. And an access token is required if you need to then make further requests to Google's APIs. So depending on what you want to do, if you want to be fast and just identify the user, use an ID token. If you want to make API calls to Google, you should use an access token. And all of this, I'll say this again, you should use the one-time code flow instead of doing this first. It's preferred because it's more secure, because that code can't be intercepted. And it also gives you a little more power, which you can read about in our documentation. So you should try to use the code flow. You also want to make sure that, if possible, you should authenticate a session so you can make multiple requests.
In cases that you don't have a session, then the solution that we're presenting today will be relevant.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So if you are not able to establish multiple requests in one session, then you need to authenticate all requests. And to do that, you can send, say, the ID token or the access token to do that. If you don't have the authorization code, then you have no choice but to use something like sending the access token to your server in order to make the requests. And right now, iOS doesn't have that. So you'll need to do that.
And we're looking into solving it in the near future.
So we want to show you briefly how to get these tokens before we talk about how to verify them. So on Android, if you want to get an ID token, you can use Google Auth Util. And they use this syntax that I have on the screen. And make sure that you do this in an async task so that it doesn't block anything in the app. And you'll get a string back that you can then send securely to your server. If you want to get an access token, you do a very similar thing, but you change the third argument to match the syntax that I have on the screen here. And these are just the way that your client will get the token and to send to your server. On the web, you do it a little bit differently. You start with the callback in from the sign-in. And in your auth result, you can get both the ID token and the access token as strings. And you can send those to your server as well. Web is most likely the one where you're going to use the code flow. So that if you can help it, you probably won't have to do this. On iOS, you get an access token in the auth object from finished with auth. And you can send that string to your server. This is the place you're most likely to use these methods because we don't have an authorization code available. So why do we want to verify these tokens? Why is that important?
Well, there are two main cases. One is when you have an invalid token, either that the token expired or the token is from an app that is not really your app, or when you have a bad client. You want to give an example for that?
Yeah, so a bad client would be like if you have an attacker who gets users to sign into their app and it gets them to hit the consent screen, that person, that developer, could send tokens and make requests to your server. And they would be real tokens. They would actually be issued by Google. So if your app just checked to make sure that they are real and then checked to see what user was attached to that, you may give an attacker access to a user's information even though that user never signed into your app.
And that's the reason that you're verifying that this token were meant for your app based on your client ID.
Absolutely. So it's very critical that you check to make sure that this token is for your app and not just someone's app on the internet.
Great.
So how we're going to do this is do two things. First, we check to make sure that the tokens are made by Google.
And then you want to check that these tokens are meant for your app using the client ID. And you can set the client ID and verify it in the dev console.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, in the Google API console, when you set up your project, you will create a web client ID. And so for depending on what type of token you're sending, you have to make sure that the client ID for that token is the one that you're checking on the server.
And you're most likely to have a different client ID for each of your apps. So for your Android app, you'll have one client ID, another one for your desktop app, and another one for your iOS.
Mm-hmm. That's correct. So depending on which token you have to do slightly different steps. Let's start with the ID token. First, we want to check to make sure it's issued by Google. So how do we do that?
Well, you check the signature using the Google API, and we'll show you the code that does it.
Mm-hmm.
And then you do the same for access token. You call the token info API.
Mm-hmm.
The second step would be to check your client ID. You compare the client ID with the token that you just read on the ID token. And again, you do it with the token API response, the token info response on your to verify the access token.
Yeah, exactly.
And then these step number one, number two are essential for this to verify the tokens. And step three is only the step that we're using for this example. You can use any other step that is relevant for your app at this stage. And we'll show you just one of those examples.
Exactly. So we're going to show you the first two steps that make sure that it's verified. And then we're going to also get the user ID because that's a useful thing for your client to know. Once you've authenticated with your server, now your client will know who the user is.
Now, do you want to repeat for those who didn't hear us, when do you need to check ID token and access token? Do you need to do it every time that you call the API or per session?
Yeah. So if the first time you make a request from that client, you always need to check it in some way. So if you've done an authorization code, that is your first connection to authenticate between your client and your server. You may not have that. So again, the first time you send an ID token or an access token, you need to do that. Every time that you get a new ID token or access token from your client that you can't trust, you need to make sure that you verify it. If you have the option, though, you should try and authenticate a session, though, so you don't have to do this check for every request that comes in from your clients.
So ideally, you'll do this check once you start the session. As long as the session is alive, you'll assume that these tokens are already valid, and you continue without checking it again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and if the session is already valid, you probably don't even need to send the ID token or the access token again because you already know who is on the other end. So great, let's look at some code. We have samples available in 5 languages. We're going to look at GitHub for PHP today. But you can pick your favorite language and see how it works. The logic is the same in all of them. So you'll even get the same responses in your client apps. So first, on Google+, we have this G+ verify token PHP. it looks very similar to our quick starts. So if you haven't done that yet, you should do the quick start first, because we think that's the one that you're going to need to use.
They're fairly simple, very easy to integrate, very easy to follow the examples that we have over there, mm-hmm. with the goal to allow you to spend less time on developing for our platform and most time on developing your actual app.
Exactly. So the relevant piece for verifying tokens in this sample is in verify.php. The files are named similarly in the other languages as well. Great. So this is very similar again to the quick starts. The main difference is that we have an endpoint slash verify. So the client, which when we run the sample is the web app, is going to send an ID token and an access token to localhost slash verify. And we're going to make sure that if there's an access token, we're going to make sure that it's real, mm-hmm. and we're going to make sure it's for your app. And then we're going to look at the access.
That's okay. We'll show you how you do the access token and ID token.
And it doesn't matter which one is which. Yeah. So we'll start by pulling the ID token and the access token into strings in PHP. Everything that we do in the sample is going to be returned in this array. So it's going to say token status is going to have information about what tokens it received. To start, we're going to have the IE token status. And we're going to create an empty array to hold that information. So we'll check the ID token first, which we're only going to do if the client sent an ID token. The really easy thing about verifying the ID token in PHP is that the client library does this for you. So we just call client verify ID token with the string, which is the ID token, and we pass it the client ID as well.
And the client library should be available for you anytime that you use our apps. If you start following the steps on a quick start or even the steps that we have in GitHub, you'll have in one of them, you'll download the client library and you'll have it for your server.
Yep. It's very straightforward. All of the complicated stuff that we've been talking about is taken care of in this function call. And what you get back is a JSON web token that contains information about the user. And we can get the Google Plus user ID from the payload under the field called sub, which stands for subscriber. The rest of the code here just takes that information and puts it into the ID status object, which we're going to get returned in the HTTP request. If the token is not valid, we throw an exception. And we know that either the token wasn't real or it wasn't issued for your app. One thing to keep in mind is that this client ID needs to be the client ID that matches the token that was sent. So if for some reason you have multiple tokens that are registered coming from different apps that are still yours,
like an Android app, an iOS app, and a desktop mm-hmm. app, all mm-hmm. different apps that you're the publisher of all of those. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so if you have tokens that have different client IDs registered, then you may need to check this multiple times to find which client ID matches your app. And then we would take this information, and we're going to return it in the token status at the when we return. That's great. That's the ID token. Let's take a look at the access token now. Very similarly, we're going to create an empty array to hold the information. If there is an access token, then we're going to make a request to the token info API. So by itself, the string doesn't contain any information. You have to use it to ask Google for something. And the token info API is a very easy way of finding out who the token is issued for. Mm-hmm. So we make this HTTP request to Google, and we read the response back. If the token is real, which means it is an access token issued by Google, then you will get no errors in your response. If you do get an error, then you know that you have an invalid access token.
And here's the place to handle those errors. You can either show a message to the user or simply drop the message from the error to your log and verify what happened and mm-hmm. continue from there.
Yep, exactly. Once you've verified that the token is from Google and is real, you want to make sure that it's issued to your app. So we check that client ID, much like we did with the ID token. Make sure that you do this step so that you avoid the problem where someone else's app sends their real access token to your server. You need to check this, otherwise you're causing problems for you and your users.
Or even the case that one app that you develop overrides the other app with, and you do some mistakes. And
So you want to make sure that you expect the right tokens from each client. And once you've checked those two things, you can trust that the access token is valid and meant for your app. And in our response, we say that the it was a valid token. We can get the Google Plus user ID from the token info response, because every token that is issued in our OAuth2 code is issued for a specific user. And so once we get that back, we know who the user is, and we've authenticated that request. We're going to say that the token is valid, put that into response, and return all that information in a JSON response.
Pretty simple.
Very good.
How will it look like in other languages?
It looks almost the same in every other language. Yes. So we have the same structure.
Mm-hmm. Same logic, just a few tweaks based on the language, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so some of these are, like you have to create an actual object in Java. You have to use different syntax, obviously, in different languages. But the logic and how you accomplish each of these things is exactly the same.
Right.
And of course, you can look through the code to figure out.
And it's all in our GitHub.
Mm-hmm. Everything that we've talked about is on GitHub, so you should try it out for yourself. Great. So thank you for joining us. Today we talked about verifying tokens. We talked about when to do it, which is when you cannot use the code flow, or you need to make requests, many requests in a way that you don't have an established session. We talked about why you need to verify these tokens, so that people need to make you're expecting to be authenticated are making real authenticated requests. You also need to make sure that attackers are not able to use their tokens to get access to your user's information. And we talked about how to do that. We have all the information on GitHub for you to check it out and try it yourself.
Great. We'll give you the ability to offer us questions. Well, I don't see any questions right now on our on YouTube or our G+ event page. If you have any questions, feel free to add them to our event page. We can take them later after this broadcast.
Yeah. And as always, you can try out our normal documentation for getting started with Google Plus sign-in at developers.google.com/plus. You can ask us questions in our Google Plus developers community or on Stack Overflow with the tag Google Plus. We're happy to get feedback on how well these things work for you, how easy they are, so that we can continue to make things better for you. But I think that that's all we have for you today. Thank you so much for joining us today, Yaniv, and we'd be happy to have you back.
Great. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, everyone. Bye.
Bye.